actually came into being in June of 2014. The office actually started as the Office of Transfer Articulation. Our director, Jane Rex, is Jane here today? She's not. Well, Jane will be having an open session on Friday to tell you all about how the office got started. But I'll tell you a little bit about it right now. It started with four ladies. We had three credit articulators and Jane. And these ladies did everything that a transfer student would need. They did credit articulation. They did advising. They did how to get connected. They did it all. And it was four ladies looking at our whole transfer student population. So through our transfer advisory board and our transfer students team and things of that nature, they decided that we needed a little bit more assistance as this population started to grow. So in June of 2014, the office changed to the Office of Transfer Services. Bob is the Jumpstart Coordinator. I came on as the Transfer Transition Advisor. That was a new position to our campus. We also got an Associate Director, and then we also brought in a dedicated Transfer Admissions Representative. And so we have a team of nine people that are dedicated to nothing but our transfer students. And then Bob, myself, and Jane Dowdy, who is our Transfer Admission Representative, we have what we call the Transmission Team. It's kind of a play on words. You get it? Yeah, all right, thank you. Some people don't get it, and they're like, what? I'm like, you get it, transmission, you gotta move. All right, so between, we have the first line of defense with admissions, and then I work with students as to, you know, what classes do you need to take at your community college or your four-year school to transfer, and then, of course, Bob helps them with Jumpstart, and I'm gonna let him tell you a little bit more about that as we go on. Let's go back a little bit. Okay. I'm going to talk a little bit about also our transfer track. This is set up through admissions, and this is just how students can come to get to know more about ASU. They come, they get a 30-minute presentation, and then we send them out with our transfer student mentors and an Appalachian ambassador so that they can tour the campus. And it's just a great opportunity for our prospective transfer students to go ahead and learn more about the campus. We also have transfer pre-orientation programming that's called TPOP. A lot of people like ask, you know, well, it's pre-orientation programming. But it's a great opportunity for our transfer students to go ahead and come and get on campus. Those of you that work at a university, you know that the day of orientation can be crazy. You've got kids going everywhere, here, there, and everywhere. So with TPOP, we bring in about 65 transfer students, and they're there to go ahead and get a head start on, you know, how to get involved on campus, career development, go ahead and get assistance with advising for their major, things of that nature. And there's actually going to be a poster presentation out there that with Nikki Kreese and Jane Rex, and they will be telling you all about TPOP and some of the other transfer orientation things that we do at ASU. We have two transfer RLCs, so residential learning communities, and these are application-based. Students apply to be in them, and then they get chosen. It's a great opportunity for the transfer students to have other support systems, you know, with other transfer students there on campus. And then we have a dedicated library staff for our transfer students. We have three lovely librarians who are nothing but transfer students. So they help them. Raise your hands. Right there they are. And they will be presenting tomorrow. So come and hear all about that. And then what you came to hear about are three transfer-specific clubs, okay? So moving on, transfer student organization. Now with the three transfer-specific clubs, they each have their own focus. With TSO, or Transfer Student Organization, this is a socially focused organization. It was developed back in 2014 by our former associate director and two of our transfer student mentors. These two students came to campus and said, you know, we need something more. Students need to get involved. Students need to feel like they have a place here on campus. Because as we all know, transfer students don't always live on campus, and so sometimes it can be hard for them to get that buy-in from campus, and they said, we want to figure out a way to get transfer students involved and make sure that they feel like they are a vital part of this campus. So the Transfer Student Organization was developed. And basically what they do is they create social activities so that transfer students can get to know each other and get involved on the campus. We do things like going to the Biltmore House. Depending on what season we're in, it may be hiking, camping, snowboarding, snow skiing, if they want to go snow tubing. Whatever the case may be, whatever a student wants to do, we figure out a way to make it happen. And so it's just a great opportunity for these students to go ahead and get that social aspect, get to know students, and also get involved whenever they might not have done that otherwise. Right now, we're at about 100 members. We're slowly becoming one of the largest organizations on campus, so we're very excited about that, and we're looking forward to seeing it grow.
So the Jumpstart program is a transfer student transition and support program. At the heart of it is a group of 16 transfer student mentors, and they and I visit five different campuses of three partner community colleges, our three leading transfer colleges. And the mentors and I will set up and basically just answer questions, help students find resources, make sure they're getting the answers, the information, and the help they need to successfully transfer. And then those mentors, we're going more into a mentoring role once the students transfer and helping them on campus find the resources and the help they need. Tau Sigma, how many folks out there have a Tau Sigma chapter? A couple, great. Melanie, wave your hand, Melanie. There's your local Tau Sigma rep right there. And she will, yeah. Tau Sigma is such an easy thing that you can add on your campus to help support transfer students, to help recognize academic achievement of transfer students, and to start forming that kind of transfer community on campus. Our first induction was in 2010. And we have more and more been trying to become an active club on campus, more than just an honor society. We're trying to provide some events for our members and trying to create some interaction among those people, other than just coming into the induction ceremony, which is really all it was in the past. Their focus is on academic achievement, and they're working right now on doing some supplemental tutoring where our learning assistance program may not be able to reach out to as many students. We're trying to find a network of students that can tutor in different areas. They do some community service events. And really, they, more than anything, they help support the other transfer clubs. And they stand to benefit the most from it because we've had a hard time getting the members active. The analogy I always use is, you know, you join the chess club because you like to play chess. You join Tau Sigma because you've been invited to, and there's really not a interest component to it other than just your high academic performance. So we're trying to provide more of that for them. The Walker College of Business Transfer Student Association was started in the spring of 2014 and really was created in the fall of 2014. Before joining the Office of Transfer Services, I was an academic advisor in our College of Business, and in reviewing the probation report, realized that about 80% of the students on probation were transfer students of one form, whether they were first semester or later. It was a small percentage of the transfer students in the College of Business that were on probation, but it was a large proportion of that probation report. So we got talking in the advising center and thinking, what are some things that we can do to help? And the suggestion of the Transfer Student Association came up. And the goal of the organization is really to reach out to transfer students in the first week or two of class to try and get them hooked into the association, to push them towards academic advising, to push them towards career development, and really help them find the resources and the support. You know, our College of Business, they're lucky. They have dedicated advisors. They have their own career service center. So we found in the advising office, if we could meet with a student within the first month or so, we could set that person off in the right direction. We could help them find the co-curricular opportunities, the academic opportunities, the support resources. But if we didn't meet with somebody until December, several weeks after early registration, it was already too late. So this student-to-student outreach we thought would be a great way to be able to grab those students right from the start and pull them into the College of Business, help them find the resources. We've been having some conversations on campus as to whether this could be a model program for some of the other colleges. College of Business has many similar majors, so it's real easy to do something like that. Our College of Health Sciences, College of Education, we could probably replicate that organization in those. Our College of Arts and Sciences, I think it's way too broad and diverse to do something like that, but we're looking at that as a model program for some of the other colleges that they can help introduce the students to the particular resources in their little world. So in fall of 2014, we had these five organizations that were all kind of, had started independently, really didn't know much about each other. The only real connection, Jumpstart, was a part of the Office of Transfer Services, and the Transfer Student Organization was started by a mentor. In that semester, I changed roles from a business academic advisor to the Office of Transfer Services, and I brought with me Tau Sigma and TSA. So now we had three of the organizations under the umbrella, and soon after, Beth became the advisor of the Transfer Student Organization. So now all of the clubs had the backing and the support of our Office of Transfer Services. We knew what they were doing, and we were able to support them. We were able to help them fulfill their missions. This is where the happy coincidence came in. We realized quickly that there were Tau Sigma members in all of the clubs. There were also, TSA, you'll hear a lot of TSs, TSO, TSA, Tau Sigma. There were TSA members in everything, and there were mentors in everything. So among the four clubs, we had a network of about 20 or more transfer student leaders who really wanted to make a difference. They realized they had their transfer experience, they had their bump in the road, and they wanted to be able to do something about it. And I mean, they were like tearing at it to be able to do something about it. We have had no trouble getting officers into these groups, and they all kind of get it. They all understand the importance of what they're doing. It's not just a leadership opportunity for them. It's an opportunity to give back and to really help all of the other students around them who are going through the same thing. So it's been a really strong network of students that when we get word that a student is struggling for any reason, I call it sending up the bat signal, and you can send it out to all these club officers and say, hey, this particular person is struggling in this class or is in this major. And you've got people clamoring to contact that student. And, you know, this semester it's happened a few times, and a month later, I'll be talking to a mentor who I didn't know had anything to do with the original conversation. Oh yeah, I met that student for coffee the other day. We've been hanging out, and I helped her find a tutor in this class. So it's creating this great culture and network of support. So in the spring of 2015, all these students were out there. We said, why don't y'all get together and just meet one another, sit down, say hello, have coffee, and see what comes out of it. And from that, they came back and said, we're gonna form a collaboration committee. We really need to figure out how we can work together, how we can support one another, what is the sum that's greater than all of these parts. Over the summer, they got a little bit off track. They overcomplicated it a little bit the first time around, but they're pulling it back together, and we've started giving the collaboration committee some leadership so that, you know, we can help them meet on a regular basis. We can help guide the conversation and help them so they're not replicating efforts, so they're not stepping on each other's toes. Last semester, one of the groups came to me, one of the group officers, and said, you know, the other group has scheduled a corn maze walk, and we've got a fundraiser at the local Appalachian Mountain Brewery that night. I says, what's the problem? Like, well, they're having an event, and we're having an event. The first event ended at 4:30. The next event began at 6. I said, that's not a problem, that's an opportunity. You know, we wanna co-market these things, we wanna cross-market these things to get students to come to both of them. So that's really the direction we're going in now, is that almost all of the events that these clubs are doing, they are reaching out to all of the other clubs to help promote it, to help get butts in seats, to help get participation, and just to help get the word out.
So in getting the collaboration committee together, as Bob said, it came together some in 2015, and one of the things that they first did whenever they came back for the fall was they had a huge welcome back pizza dinner between the three clubs. And this was a great opportunity for the students to renew on campus, to get to know each other again. It was a social aspect. But we had about 100 to 120 students, maybe a little bit more, give or take, out of that 1,400 new student population that came in. So we were very excited about that. And as you can see, we had, this is our solarium at App State, and we had it completely filled. So we were very, very excited for that opportunity for those students to come. And then as the semester went on, they started looking at other opportunities that they could do. So one of the things that they did as far as fundraising money was they went to the Comeback Shack fundraiser. So Comeback Shack is one of our local burger joints. It's locally owned by a family that's from Boone, and so they're very into supporting Appalachian and our other schools around the area. And so this was promoted by all the organizations. So basically you go in, you say, I'm with TSO, I'm with TSA, or I am a Tau Sigma member, and like 15% of the proceeds go to the organizations. They were able to raise about $158 that they split amongst themselves. And that was just a good opportunity for them to have a successful collaboration event. So as they've continued to collaborate, and we're looking at other things, the Spring 2016 Welcome Back pizza dinner. Now we put this together and they with their assistance, and as I said, our spring class was about 400 students. Well, we had about a fourth of those students show up to this pizza dinner. I would say between 80 and 100 students showed up. As you can see, they're all sitting right there, and it was a huge success for us to have that many students out of 400 whenever we only had like about 120 out of that 1,400. So to us, that's a, you know, that's a huge number. It's a huge growing number. It really shows that the efforts that these students are putting forth are doing good, and that the students are appreciating it. So we're very excited that as these students continue to think about things to do, whether it be community service or the social aspects of getting together and going hiking, or whatever it is that they may be doing, that they're going to continue to do it together and bring all these students into one group.
So it's great we're getting the brand new students and the ones who have been around for a while and kind of mixing them together. In the spring dinner, I was really impressed. I was kind of looking around and I was looking at some pictures after the fact, and transfer student mentors and officers of all of these clubs were, there was like one at each table. We hadn't talked about that beforehand, but they kind of spread themselves out. They were really welcoming all of these students and really trying to, you know, as you're talking to somebody, one biology major, oh, that guy over there is biology major too. You need to hook up with him, you need to take classes together probably. And that person over there is one of the transfer mentors, and she's a biology major, so you definitely want to talk to her. So we were able to really easily make those connections while they were sitting around eating pizza.
Was there a charge to attend?
No.
Organizations.
Some of that money came from the collaboration fundraiser. Tau Sigma is lucky in terms of organizations in that our membership dues and what you get back, the dues are $45. 30 of it goes to the national organization and 15 stays with the local chapter. So Tau Sigma typically has $500 or $600 in the bank, so we help with that. Also, one of the guys in orientation has a hookup with all the local restaurants because they order pizza and subs and everything all the time. So they help fund some of that. But really, we pay $20 for the tip, and we bought some drinks. I think are really the only cost. For the spring one, we had no idea, was it going to be 20 students or was it going to 120 students. We got food for, I think, 75. We ran out. I didn't hear any complaints. When I left at about 8:30, there were still probably 30 to 40 students still hanging out, sitting in little groups at different tables, which I thought was great. I thought after the food went and we stopped talking, they don't scatter, but they stayed around. So our hopes for the future, we really want to build that strong transfer community. And you transfer students don't want to be transfer students, they just want to be students. I think we're trying to make being a transfer student a value-added thing. I have found and I have seen that they want to self-identify as being a transfer student because they recognize that their experience is a little bit different, a little bit special, especially when they can interact with other students who have been through the same situation. So we're really trying to develop that transfer community. We're starting a tradition of transfer students helping transfer students. And when I was an advisor, I realized, who does a student get most of their information from? Anybody? Other students. Sometimes that information is even correct. Much of the time, it is not. But they are more than willing to be each other's advocate to help one another. So with this strong network of transfer students, all kind of under and involved with our office, we can help them get correct information to pass on to everyone else.
That's great because, you know, if the students don't know the answer, then a lot of times they'll say, well, let's go see the Office of Transfer Services. They'll refer to us, you know, and so they understand the resources that the students need and they know how to help them get there. So it's very exciting to see the students getting connected and working together
in that way. Yeah. I mean, I say, well, how can we leverage this? Like, how can we use this more? It's really, we're really in the early stages, we're really in the infancy of this, so, you know, come on back next year and we'll tell you how it's going, but I think so far, I've just been pleased as can be with the interaction of the clubs, with the willingness of all of its leaders. They really want to create this inviting environment for all transfer students. Yeah.
We have,
I'm
the Murray City. We have similar transfer numbers as far as the size of school and the size of the transfer population. I have two questions.
Sure.
It sounded like you got down to the number of about 20 board members at one point. I think when you said when you looked at all the organizations.
Well, there's a dozen, well, anywhere from a dozen to 18 transfer student mentors, depending on the semester and how active everybody is. So somewhere in that ballpark. And then there's four officers for each club, but there's a lot of crossover. You know, the president of Transfer Student Organization is a mentor. The president of Tau Sigma is a mentor. The president of the College Business Association is not a mentor, but he's part of TSO. So yeah, I'd say, you know, 20, 25.
Okay, so we tried multiple times to start an organization. We try to find the young start students and where the students that will be go-getters or playing in. So
yeah.
Not a whole lot of success yet, right now.
You have Tau Sigma?
What was that?
You have Tau Sigma?
No. Work.
All right.
So, but
you see this guy?
Yeah.
Right.
So we try to come to the number of students that we want to find committed to it.
Mm-hmm.
20, I think, is the number that we've tossed around. And I heard you say, I think at one point someone said 20 times, maybe that's, like, if we get 20 students on board for one meeting to say, let's change how stressful the training starts to be, that sounds like our platform to launch. Is that?
That's a great question. You know, TSO has had the best luck with getting people to meetings and getting people active. And really what the two transfer student mentors that started it, they took the names from summer transfer orientation. We do three summer transfer orientations. Is that right? Three?
Four.
Correct. They took all of those names and they just kept emailing them and saying, we're starting this organization and to start with, we're gonna go do a hike or we're gonna get together for a potluck. And they have been really successful in just getting people to come to their meetings.
I will say, saying that, the two transfer student mentors that started that group were extremely extroverted, and they were on campus, they were involved. One was a poli-sci major, one was a PR major, and I mean, they were just out there. They were putting, you know, their feet to the ground, and they were getting involved, and they were meeting students wherever they could, you know, being willing to go up to a student and say, hey, are you a transfer? You know, we're doing this, and it may just be, you know, just out of the blue. So they were very, very active in making that happen. So I think in looking at the students that you're trying to recruit, you know, think about those students that are the most active. You know, who was going to be willing to put forth that work and be motivated to get up?
I think we've been really lucky. We have found some great students. I mean, you know, the transfer student mentors that we have now, they just get it. They get what they're doing. They understand the importance of it in the same way as these club officers. They're not just doing it for a leadership position. They're doing it for that. But they're also, they realize that there's a much larger context that they're doing this in. And I think all of this kind of falling under the Office of Transfer Services, we try to remind them on a regular basis. And when I go to officer meetings and when I meet with the presidents individually, we continue to remind them, this isn't just the chess club. You're not just hanging out playing chess. What you're doing can literally be saving the students, you know, and helping them to be successful. It's important what you're doing, and they get it.
So,
so a transfer student at Appalachian is a student who has usually been graduated from high school for at least 1 year, has attended another university, and has at least 30 hours of transferable credit. Okay?
Okay, second question. So Bob said water labor. This whole time I've been listening to you, Bob, that's the thing I was thinking about. It's great to have pizza parties, it's great to go on hikes, have these events. But if I think of a student organization that's 120 strong, I think of advocacy, transfer advocacy. So, in an ideal share of governance, you got a group of advocates who could basically help the administration understand the struggles, barriers, processes that you refine to assist with this whole transfer transition, sitting on SGA. I mean, if you got a group that large, you really have left.
One of the transfer student mentors and the president of Tau Sigma just texted me yesterday saying, I think I need to pass on the presidency of Tau Sigma to the vice president because he's running for SGA. He's running for president of SGA. And he single-handedly filled like 8 or 9 positions on SGA with transfer students. You know, so we're really trying to do that. And, you know, we have a great pool of students. There are transfer students on our transfer advisory team. And they are advocating. And as I said, we're in the early days of this, so we're still trying to figure out what is the potential of all this. I think it's great. I think there's great potential there. We just need to figure out how to make the best use of it. Yeah?
You spoke about your TSO organization.
Sure. The question was about TSO and some of the events that they've done. Can you go back a slide? The middle picture there is a group of them. They went to Biltmore House, which is in Asheville. That was really successful. They did a camping trip that was pretty successful. They just get a lot of members to their meetings. I think part of it is promotion, and I think the original officers of it, as Beth said, were very outgoing, were very connected to the transfer community, and they weren't just saying, hey, we're having this meeting. They were like, you're coming with me to this meeting, and then everybody who came to the meeting, all right, the next time you come to the meeting, bring somebody with you, and it's just grown. So really, I mean, they're doing simple things. You know, they did a potluck.
Any of those activities that a student might want to do, they don't want to do by themselves, you know, or they're a little bit intimidated by, they're looking at those activities. Basketball games, you know, just getting students to go to basketball games on campus, things of that nature.
Yeah, they went to football games.
It is. It's small activities that create a large impact in somebody's life. If you told them the story about the student there was a student that came to the fundraiser, the collaboration committee fundraiser at Comeback Shack. And she apparently looked at one of the presidents and said, "I feel very isolated here. I feel extremely isolated. I don't know anybody. I don't know how to get involved. This is, you know, the first time I've ever been to a university." And she was basically in tears. Well, that president ended up calling like five other students and saying, "We need to get this girl involved." The next afternoon, the girl had a dinner date. She had a coffee date. She had a whatever she wanted date. So it was getting filled up. And so that's one of the things that they really try to do. And it's not just TSO that does that. It'll be TSA if they have that also, or a Tau Sigma member, whatever it may be. The transfer students at Appalachian are creating a community through these organizations. And that's one of the things we're most proud of.
In the Jumpstart program, we have a Facebook page. And after the pizza dinner in the spring, I posted some pictures on there, and there was a comment the next day from a young woman from a local community college saying, "That looks like so much fun. I can't wait to come next semester." I was like, "Oh, that's great." Over here, yeah.
I work at the University of Louisville in our Office of Transfer and Health Services, and I coordinate our Transfer Ambassador Program. Do you all offer any type of incentives in the recruitment process for the mentorship program through your office?
Right now, our mentors they're paid $10 an hour. We're kind of going away from that model. That's a double-edged sword, really. You know, the more they're paid, then they start thinking, "Well, I'm doing these extra hours. Do I get paid for that?" So we kind of started a policy this semester. They get paid for official events. If they're going to a community college to work for the day, if they're working at transfer pre-orientation, if they're going to transfer orientation, they get paid for those things. But the other stuff, if I call them and say, "Hey, Susie's struggling, will you take her out for coffee?" they don't expect to get paid. And they're fine with it. And one of the mentors approached me this semester and said, "You know, I would like to bring another mentor with me when I go to the community college. Can we do that and each take half pay?" Sure. So, you know, I would like to go away. We have our university ambassadors. The College of Business has their Walker Fellows, which are the same thing. I would like the mentors to go in that direction, to really be, for this to be a leadership program for them, for this to be a developmental opportunity for them. And they've all embraced that. They're not doing any of this for the pay. Yes?
I'm from Rowan University, and I am in Office of One from University of Transfer Services. I have a fantastic intern who I just saw. She's sitting over there. And she has set up a mentoring program. My question for you is about funding. Where does your funding source come from? Are you under strategic management?
That lady right there gives me money.
Well, it would be good to know that this started as a grant program. So part of the grant was that they were getting paid. There was funds for payment. So that's why, of course, the grant is gone. It has been established as a full program at the university. But now we're trying to wean away, because we don't have funding really for the, like we did with the grant. So that's why we're trying to wean away from the cost, the $10 an hour or whatever. And again, like Bob said, it's a leadership development opportunity. I thought Bob did. I'm the director. I'm the director in the Office of Transfer Services.
So this is Jane, who I mentioned earlier, and she wasn't in here. So this is Jane Rex, the director of Office of Transfer Services.
Yes.
Go ahead. So I have a much smaller scale operation. Starting to develop a transfer ambassador program. I work in the admissions office, so we've kind of just taken this on to get students involved, current students, and help them become our new students. Now, our students are very excited, but it's very hard to get them to plan their own program. They rely very heavily on us to plan any sort of activities. Do you have any sort of advice to kind of empower our students to take this on their own as their initiative?
I think finding the right students is the most important thing. I think that's key. And, you know, with the mentors, I was hiring them. I had several interest meetings over the course of last spring and had about 75 students interested. of them, about 36 applied, and of them, I interviewed 20-ish and hired 12. Last year was a big year, a lot from the previous cohort graduated, so I hired a lot. And with the officers of the other clubs, part of it's just been lucky. And we're developing this community of students who want to do this, who get it, who want to be active, who want to help other transfer students. They're not just doing it to put a tick mark on their resume. There's a question over here. Yeah.
Yeah, you mentioned that it's critical for your students to visit the community colleges early on before they start planning for their classes. How do you get into the community colleges? How does that work? Do you contact professors, department chairs? Is it class presentations, or how does that work?
All of the above. We have three partner community colleges, the Jumpstart program does. And we hit five campuses of those three colleges. I think we worked with counseling centers, advising centers, and this year I'm really trying to work more closely. North Carolina has the ACA 122, which is the Transfer Student Success course that anybody in the transfer program needs to take. So I've really been reaching out to ACA instructors, and we've had really good response. I did a couple last week, I'm doing a couple more next week, and we're really trying to develop partnerships with the coordinators of those ACA classes. Because if you hit all of those in a semester, you're pretty much hitting everybody who's going to transfer, and trying to get them those resources up front and knowledge of these clubs.
Follow-up, is the messaging when you talk to these community colleges, is it transfer to a university or join the club?
Well, the clubs aren't recruiting from the community college. They're getting students who have already transferred. And, you know, and when at least when I go to community college campuses, I don't look at myself as a recruiter. I'm not out there going, come to Appalachian. I'm saying, how can I help you if you want to come to Appalachian? What's the information I can get you? What are the resources? Hey, come to campus. I'll set you up with a meeting with you know, the chair of the English department, or whatever. You know, we want to get them to campus and you know, we talked about several of the programs we have. By the time a student has come to our transfer track visit, maybe did transfer pre-orientation, and then came to transfer orientation, they've been on campus three times, and they've you know, walked around, they've seen where things are, they may have met with people in the department, they've been in orientation with students in similar majors, so they're starting to make those connections.
And then we also do outreach to other community colleges. So Jane Dowdy and I, you know, as Jane's going off with admissions and doing, you know, admission work at the community colleges, and then I'm going and meeting with advisors and doing webinars and things of that nature, we're also getting that information out to them at that point too. So it's the three community colleges that Jumpstart works with, and then, it's, you know, North Carolina has 58 community colleges. So it's also working with them to make sure that they have that information, so as students are looking to transfer to Appalachian, you know, those advisors can work with them also. So it's really, you know, statewide outreach is what we're looking to do.
I don't know if it's okay.
All right, sorry. I like to get my exercise.
They told us do a breakout, it'll be small.
Do you guys notice?
Do you notice a lot of, sorry. Do you notice a lot of non-traditional students and veteran students involving themselves in these organizations?
That is a great question. Mm-hmm. Not a ton. The question was, do we see non-traditional and veteran students getting involved in these? Not a ton, although there's a woman on campus now, Gail Pinkham, and she is probably in her 60s. She's on SGA. She said, I'm going to do college. I'm going to do college. I'm going to do it. I'm going to do everything that I missed out on. I think it's more challenging for the non-traditional students, especially those that don't live right in Boone. We're open to it. And as far as the military, we're actually right now in the process of hiring for a student veterans center coordinator, like a point of contact for veteran students, so we can try to create more outreach for them. We have a student veterans association, and it has waxed and waned over the years. You know, so it's been real active for a couple semesters, and then not, just depending on who's leading it.
And TSO has looked at considering, you know, a non-traditional student subgroup of them, because we do realize that, you know, non-traditional students can have a harder time getting to the meetings at 7 o'clock. If you've got kids, you don't really want to tug your two-year-old with you. So they are looking at maybe creating some sort of subgroup to address the non-traditional students so that they feel like they have a spot on campus also.
But, you know, we had older students at both of the pizza dinners. I mean, that's a start. They're out and they're wanting to do something. Yes.
Thanks. Along those same lines, I'm interested in how many of your transfer students are residential, how many are commuting, and do you notice that in your involvement in these clubs?
Well, housing on campus for transfer students is somewhat limited. It is increasing. As I mentioned before, we do have two dorms, Belk and Frank, that have the transfer RLCs. So many of our students do live off campus. We do have some students that are commuting, because we do have quite a few community colleges that are 30 or 45 minutes away. And then, of course, our distance ed students who are doing, you know, distance education either online or at the various community college campuses where we have like small satellite offices and campuses. So of all of our, I would say that, you know, most of our transfer students probably live in Boone in some form, but there is a good portion of them that also commute.
All of Boone is about the size of this hotel.
Yes.
So living off campus is like living across the hall. You know, they're still close to campus. And we have, there's a free bus service that runs around town that, you know, it's easy to get to and from campus. And you know, even if you live off campus, you're still pretty involved with campus.
You had a question over here, right here.
Just real quick, I have a question, but I was going to also mention, just last year at University of Central Florida, we did a veterans, non-traditional family fun day on a Saturday, where we had Tau Sigma did a bounce house for the kids. So that was really successful, and we're going to do it again this year, but that's not my question. My question is about your mentoring program. Besides going out to the other schools, what do they do for the currently enrolled students on campus?
That's a great question, and right now, not as much as we would like them to be doing. And we've been in conversations. I think it's great to have the mentors on the community college campuses, but they don't have as much knowledge as I do. You know, I can help a student more, find resources, find answers. So we're really thinking about using the mentors. Right now, they're more like, mentor is not the right word of what they're doing now. We're working in that direction, and that's something that we would like in terms of like breaking up the incoming class of transfer students and giving each mentor, you know, 100 students to email a couple times before the beginning of the semester, and then follow up with them once a month and try and start creating those relationships. And
some kind of mentoring. I mean, we have peer mentors in our office that help with advising, like pre-admission advising, but we're looking more for mentoring where they can like be just a support system for us. So that's
Yeah, and I think that is a direction that that the Jumpstart program will go in the future. And you know, you mentioned having the event for non-traditional and veterans. We've talked. It didn't happen this past fall semester, but what we wanted to do was have the three transfer organizations invite non-traditional, invite distance ed students to a football game, especially distance ed, because they're like the, you know, the forgotten class of student. And in our Tau Sigma, there's a huge population of distance ed students in there. So we wanted to invite them, and that, you know, that's something that we'll be working on for the future.
Other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I work at Cornell, and our main focus for our transfer students is actually yielding. Our students, I'm just wondering, as far as mentors or within these groups of students, do they engage in anything through the yield process after students are admitted with those questions about transitioning or what life will be like for them? So kind of in between the mentor process and working on community colleges, but that really specific part of when after they're admitted.
Once a student is admitted to ASU, they can still continue to, you know, get support as far as they can work with the mentors, they can work with the Facebook. You know, we get a lot of what thing Bob hasn't mentioned is that the mentors are on Facebook quite a lot. So, you know, you can get part of that Facebook group, and then students can type in any question that they have, and whether it's an admitted perspective, whatever it may be. So we try to work with our admitted students. You know, we have things such as TPOP, as I mentioned earlier, and that's a great event that I talked about. You know, the transfer pre-orientation, the orientation session, and then once they are actually here on campus, our new associate director has done great things with Welcome Weekend. This past spring, we had our first Welcome Weekend for our spring students, and she came on in November and was able to pull that together for us very, very quickly, and she was very great about getting out there and really talking to people on campus and finding out, you know, what can we do? I mean, we live in Boone, it's January, so we have to think about what the weather may be like as students are coming back, you know? So she was very good about making sure that students had options so that once they got there and they're waiting on classes to begin, they're getting everything that they need done, but also getting connected. So we're building on those events, and I think as we continue to grow, I think that that's gonna become something that we continue to build on.
And we came up with those events. You know, we threw it together pretty quickly. It was being put together right before the holiday break, but we reached out to the officers and to the mentors, and we were able to staff everything. You know, they want to do
things.
They want to help.
What did they do? Scavenger hunt on campus to help them figure out their classes. You know, where everything was on campus. Strategic points of that. They did a
campus tour. They did a tour downtown, and the campus tour was kind of like walk your schedule. So they met as a group, and you know, the students could bring their schedules with them, and they could tell them where everything was.
They
went downtown. They did a hike in some pretty nasty weather, but they did a hike.
You got to get used to it, right? We just threw them right in and said, "Go for it. It's cold and it's raining. Go for a hike on grandfather." What other questions? Yes, ma'am.
Do you do any service events?
Well, that's something that we're looking to do. We had the collaboration committee the other day, and I was talking to the TSA president, and he was like, "Well, last football season, we volunteered to go clean up the football stadium after a football game," and I was like, "Really? We pay people to do that. You're crazy." You know, it's like, let's talk about a service event that is going to be at like the hospitality house, things of that nature. And they're looking at things that are going in that direction. They did hospitality house, which is, you know, our homeless shelter, going and feeding homeless individuals. And they're looking at what else they can do. Boone is a really great service area. So there's all sorts of options. We have things like the turkey trot at Thanksgiving. And so there's different options that they can do. We've just got to get them out there. And I think through this collaboration committee, we're going to be able to make that happen that much more so.
One of our Tau Sigma officers, and this is two sets of officers ago, was really active with Autism Speaks. Mm-hmm. And she developed that relationship with Tau Sigma. She's long gone, but that's kept on. So yeah, they're all doing some community service. And now that this collaboration committee has been a little bit more formalized and has a little bit more direction, that's definitely in the works.
Other questions?
Yes.
Socializing in your office, it seemed like that brought a lot of collaboration.
Definitely.
But I'm just wondering too, with the growth of the students, have you seen an increase in faculty and staff wanting to get involved, and or has your office done more intentional outreach to help educate fellow faculty and staff about the needs of your students?
We are always doing outreach. Jane has the Nat approach to outreach. I say it's not the Nat, it's the Nat approach, not the Kool-Aid guy approach. You know, it's like around you, you know, what about transfer students instead of like, what about transfers? But yeah, I think our office is always doing that outreach. I think creating that student culture is continuing that outreach. the College of Business Transfer Student Association officers sent an email out to faculty, you know, asking them to be a little bit more aware of who their transfer students are. So I think we're really trying, you know, we're creating that culture. We've talked about having a transfer awareness day or week or something, just to, you know, a third of our students are transfer students, yet they don't even know it. When I tell them that number, they're all surprised. So, you know, you can't tell a transfer student walking across campus. So we're trying to create that culture, we're trying to create that awareness, and the student collaboration is just one more way that we can do it.
We also have the opportunity to hold workshops on campus last semester. Bob wasn't able to, he set it up and I was able to facilitate a conversation among faculty and three of our transfer student mentors so that the faculty can understand what these students are encountering as they are transferring to our campus, you know, and what are their needs in the classroom. That's something that I think that a lot of the faculty don't understand, so that was a good opportunity to get that information out to them.
So if anybody has any questions, definitely find us throughout the course of the rest of the week. We'll be at the bar answering questions in a little while.
Sure, why not? Come join us for sure. And we ask that if you want some more information or contact, we've got a flyer up here. And also, as you're leaving, if you could fill out your feedback forms and then leave those with us or hand them out back, we'd appreciate that greatly. And again, if you have any more questions, please feel free to ask. Thank you.